This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
The aftermath of every social revolution brings about change. Cultural norms and landmarks shift as our minds and hearts expand beyond the familiar. To everything, there is a season and a time to every purpose in the land of the living. This is our time to renew, revive, and restore the hope lost to the busyness of life. This is our time to dig again and rebuild from the storms of our past on a solid footing that holds. Welcome to The Foundation.
The Foundation. Foundation.
The Foundation with Heart Grant is brought to you by Alive, Bahamas Welding and Fire, Bonneville Bones, Burger King, Carey's Fabric and Uniform Store, Commonwealth Bank, Epic Battery, Grand Bahama News, Marco's Pizza, and Printmasters.
Taking shots in here. You want one?
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, 96.9 FM radio, Howard Grant in your company, The Foundation. My producer definitely wants to take a shot to that. I just want to let you know that, right? We're here live in full effect on this beautiful day, guys. Grateful to be in your company. It is a beautiful day. Grateful. Listen, man, I see a little overcast. I'm hoping that it don't rain crazy. You can get your car washed and hang out this weekend. I think that's what the weekend's for. I realize that living here in the Bahamas, you got to be able to enjoy the weekends. Because you got to get back into the rat race on Monday. So let's just see if we're going to be able to do that in safety, in decency, and in order. Got to shout out my good, decent people over at AFS Insurance Agents and Brokers. They got everything laid out for you. Make sure you go and check them out. Number 407, Blue Hill Road South. If you get your, if you just get your agreement, your memorandum of understanding for your license plates, right? Let me be decent. If you got your letter of intent for you to be able to get your plates and you got everything down, you want to be able to find out more information on how you could be able to get your bulk insurance, check them out. 3411 AFS, 3411 AFS, in-house financing. They can take very good care of you. Ask for my good friend Ethric Bo. They're open 9 to 5 on the weekdays and 9 to 2 on Saturday. It's a beautiful day, guys. I want to be able to kind of talk about some things. All those persons celebrating your birthday. My sister-in-law celebrating her birthday. My mother celebrated her anniversary. All those persons are there celebrating birthdays and anniversaries or just sort of a commemoration day. I want to be able to say happy day to you. Whatever this day is, happy birthday, happy anniversary, happy to you. So we can be able to do that, guys. It's a beautiful thing. Make sure you pick up your Guardian newspapers. Got to shout out my good, decent people over at Coco Plum Bistro. I always tell you about them. I tell you this is where Gabriel likes to go to be able to enjoy himself anytime he feel like, let's be fancy today and enjoy ourselves and have like a nice, he like how he's big bread across the table. So he wants to be able to do that and enjoy that. He has a meal there that he enjoys at Coco Plum Bistro. It's the chicken nuggets and the fries and whatnot. He enjoys that. And the burger, he actually had a burger. He devoured that thing. Guys, good food, good service, good refreshing drinks. It is a wonderful place to kind of hang out. Make sure you go check out my good, decent people over at Coco Plum Bistro. Give them a call, 677-6776, or hit them up, opentable.com, to make your reservations. They can assist you. They are in the Green Plaza. Is it the Green Plaza? The Green Plaza, when you're headed west towards when you're headed west towards Lyford Key, it's right there on the right-hand side. You can be able to do that. So I'm sure that Chantel is going to send me some information as to whether or not they have anything special this weekend going on. We know that they did some stuff for Father's Day. We know that they did some stuff for U.S. Independence, Bahamian Independence. They had the sauce, the chicken sauce, the whole thing. They're always doing some beautiful things down there at Coco Plum Bistro, so you can be able to do that. And I'm going to tell you a little bit more about them just before we get out of here and talk about these things. Guys, pick up your Guardian newspaper. All the information's in there. You're going to be able to find out exactly what's going on in the country. We are honoring the Memorandum of Understanding with the union ministers fires back at union leaders claim. Minister of Labor and Public Services Pierre Glover-Rolle insisted yesterday that the Davis administration is living up to the terms of the Memorandum of Understanding, the MOU, that it signed and unions signed with union leaders in 2021. And let's be very clear. This was 2021 prior to September. Let's be very clear. This was 2021 prior to an election victory. Remember when they were looking for some resolve? They were looking for transformation. They thought that they did this ingenious thing. They came together as a conglomerate. They went to the PLP, which was the Royal Opposition at the time, and they signed this kind of a, you remember this? We talked about this 3 days ago. How can you now, Manderson? Anyway, we can get into that story. Let's talk about this. But anyway, let's read on with the story. They signed this agreement in 2021. Glover-Rolle says that she's firing back at the Trade Congress. TCU President Obie Ferguson claims that the government is failing to adhere to the Memorandum of Understanding. Apart from a few items of the Memorandum of Understanding that may still be outstanding, I think we've done an excellent job of living up to our part, living up to our end of the bargain regarding the Memorandum of Understanding, considering that we still have time left during this administration's term, and in fact, that some items were possibly low-hanging fruit that we could have handled and ameliorated quickly. Now, this is what she said. She actually went further and being able to talk about that. She says that other matters are at work, are a work in progress. Now, you know something? I give this guy some money one time. When I first get my truck, I get my truck lightly damaged, right? It was just a light damage in the front. The fender was mashed. But then when you go check the thing out, some other things was done. So my parts guy, my parts, so he did all the stuff for me. Shout out to Michael Fox. You know him, right? So he did everything for me. He says, Howard, you might as well just get your fender, get the door, get this, get that, get everything. Boom, boom, boom. One time. He said, because you want your truck looking nice and fresh. So I said, okay, no problem. I purchase it. I say, how much do you think these things can cost? He said, I don't know. I have this guy who's do it. So I said, you know this guy? He said, no, but he's been doing these things for me for a couple of weeks, a couple of months. And, you know, we're comfortable with him. He's always brought those things in. So I said, okay, no problem. Met up with this guy, talked to him, tell him what I want. He found out the information. The thing costs about $3,000. About $3,000, right? So I squeezed my $3,000 together, finally get the money. And I call him. I say, come get your $3,000, right? So I gave him the money. He gave me the receipt, indicated what he was going to get from me. And 1 month gone, he didn't get it. Now, this is the beginning of the lockdown when I give him this money. 1 month gone, he didn't get it. 2 months gone, he didn't get it. 12 months gone, he didn't get it. And so I went back to Mike, and me and Mike started having this kind of a conversation. I said, I don't know what's going on. This fella ain't come here with this yet. Boom, boom, boom. And so Mike and I have a good relationship. And I say, Mike, I ain't like this. So I went to the police. This is where I get now to the story. So I said to the police, this is the issue what I have. So the police said, has he brought you anything? I said, yeah, he only bring me the bumper and the fender. He said, well, listen, you can't say the fella stole it. Because once he gave you one or two of the items, despite the fact you hadn't gotten the bulk, it's a civil matter. It's not a matter that the police can indicate that he actually stole from you. He has not produced all as yet, but he has made significant efforts in terms of being able to get that. Is that what's happening here? Is that what we're hearing from Pierre Glover in this particular posture and position? That you cannot say that we haven't lived up
to our position in the memorandum of understanding because we've provided you this, this, and this. Now, we should have done some more things. However, don't reject the fact that we've done some things for you. See, this is the problem that I have here. I'm going to be decent with you. This is the problem that I have here. And I feel like the union leaders are kicking themselves in the butt. As they think back on their desperation, we always say in this space, you never negotiate in a desperate state. People read that, they get sniff it out on you. You never negotiate in a state of desperation. You never negotiate with vulnerability dripping off of you. This gullible posture, this relentless desire, this belief that you're getting over on the others, you screw yourself. And not only yourself, those people who stand behind you to believe that you made the right decision. This was a horrible decision. And unions in this country, and I can't even, I won't take some out the bucket, but I got to be able to make the bucket wide. And if you have an issue, I'd love you to call me. Unions in this country over the past two decades have lost their flair, their teeth, their tenacity, their bite, their intellectual fortitude, their posture, their position, their relentless stand, their conviction, their state, their purpose, their focus. They have lost it all. And all this is a daily transaction to be able to get union monies and give this satisfying posture to tell your members, well, you know, we're doing our best. It's the government. We're doing our best. It's the government. These people are ready to sit on the grass. They're ready to do whatever it takes. But they need leadership to help them make those first steps. But you're in bed with the PLP. This is the letter that you signed. You signed this letter. You signed this. You signed the thing and you were proud. You went in the front of the newspaper proud. To say that we've made this decision and we know that this PLP government, the government that committed to being able to ensure that the grassroots is taken care of in this new day administration, in this new dispensation, they will take care of us. Now you're in the paper saying, we don't know. You haven't done all these things. What you expect? What you expect? You need to wait till the marital ceremony before you move in with the man. My God, I just want to be decent as I talk like this. You got to wait until legality is taken care of and you can identify and you could stand in conviction and hold these people. We've watched union lost their vigor. We've watched the government take on the posture, relentless governments over the past 2.5, almost 3 decades, take on the posture of the corporate entity. Even with this conversation now about medicinal cannabis, they are giving a genuflection and an opportunity to the Rastas. Man, talk to me, man. Be talking today. Yeah, we can throw a little blow in there. But now you want to have a bigger conversation about Big Pharma, about the importance of being able to ensure that everything is funneled through there, still taking the opportunity away from the young entrepreneur, the young businessman. Governments for 30 years or more in this country have genuflected to big business, to big organization, to these amalgamated entities that can be able to go contrary. And the union is supposed to stand firm. And they haven't done that. They haven't. Everywhere you turn is an industrial indifference. And see, when you start to have these kind of a conversation, the union is there to be able to ensure that they could be able to mitigate against the turmoil and the upheaval or the unrest that exists in these. But there's only unrest when someone open their mouth and say that there's an issue. The issue exists, you know. The issue existed. This water and sewage issue in Eleuthera existed a long time. The people said it wasn't bad. And you tell you all 3 weeks ago, almost 6 weeks now. The young lady say, man, I got to go smoke something because I'm bad for 4 days, 3 days. I can't deal with this. She was agitating, but because no formality said anything, you don't think that there's unrest there? Unrest exists within the space of BPL. Despite what the union said, unrest exists. You only believe that this unrest exists when union members or official members say something? No, man. Issues exist within the hotel. Issues exist within the teachers' union. Issues exist within these particular capacities that they're working in. People are calling me every day, indicating that I've been working in this particular space as a teacher for 14 years, and I haven't been given a proper... Then, no, you won't hit me with all the technicalities and technically and this and that and all these things. Talk to them then and deal with it. Let's deal with it. Let's deal with these things. I get called from some people who've been on the government program for years. My God, you've been on the government 52 weeks, probably the longest 52 weeks ever. This is the longest 52 weeks ever. Contracts are modified within the confines of these organizations to ensure that the organization is always covered. So they don't even give you a contract beyond 6 months no more. They don't even give you the posture and position that you could present yourself as, hey, listen, I've been working here for X amount of time, and I'd like to know whether or not you're going to hire me full term. This is it. This is what the unions have done. There needs to be a new face for the union. I like Gobi. But, you know, the time is come and gone. We got to start having a very clear conversation. Unionship member advocacy and a very clear understanding of what needs to happen in the future, that needs to happen with a mind that understands the era and the time that we live in. You see, no old time concept. That's what y'all doing. Y'all doing old-time business in a new era. That's why these people swinging you left, right, and center. And they could hit you with the jargon. They could hit you with the frequency of words and that kind of a rhythm that exists in this particular space, and you can't say nothing. Because technically, they right. Technically, you have lost. Unions have lost. They have been, Grammy say, your foot short. They have been 1 foot short relentlessly over the past some decades. Unless you got to go jump on the back of a car and agitate. That's the BUT. That's Belinda. She can row, she can get up, she can say what she got to say, but all these other persons genuflecting and hoping that something happened. That's not the point of being in the union. You got to agitate and use the elements that you got to get to your objective. This kind of a posture, and we're good friends with these political people, it's not working. Because there are members who paying you every week that are not satisfied. And you're not finding a better position for them. Now you in here, Pia is technically right. She is technically right. Technically. And we got more time. Technically. You're just unsatisfied with the fact that you jumped the gun and signed that thing too early. Let's have a very clear conversation about these things. You sell the people out. You sold out. You should not have done that. You shouldn't dabble in politics. You should stand in your sovereignty and the anonymity and the strength of your union and the conviction of your position, as opposed to being able to step into these spaces. Leave politics alone. Your union members don't care about FNM or PLP. There are a plethora of persons that support the union. And they support your leadership and the conviction that you presented and that strength and tenacity that you presented. Then you go and throw your hand in with the PLP. Now you're saying, oh, but everyone could tell you this was going to happen. You don't even have a leg to stand on now because of what was done prior. Let's have a clear conversation with these things. Talk about it, all right? It's 12:35. I want you guys to be able to be a part of the conversation. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259, anywhere from the family of violence, 242-300, 5720. Hit me up, 422-4796. Got to take this quick commercial break, guys, and be right back after this. Looking so fine, I'm gonna find me a honey. You try to rest, but roll with the best. For all your printing needs, there ain't no one better, no. For posters and banners, magazines and flyers,
for window decals, reading cards and newsletters. No job too big and there's no job too small. You name it, we can print it. Just give us a call. Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life.
Located in the Nassau Guardian Building, telephone 302-2361.
Get ready to celebrate independence the BK way with our new Independence King Combos. Choose from our classic flame grilled beef version or indulge in a crispy chicken breast topped with savory bacon, arugula, crisp onion rings, cheese, and our special tropical sauce. Both come with fries and a drink for a flavor sensation perfect for celebrating every year. Remember to top off your Independence King Combo with a delicious guava sundae or the new guava ice shaker, available only at Burger King Nassau.
It's the most wonderful time of the year.
Parents, it's that sweet time of year again.
The kids are going back to school.
So pick up your copy of the Nassau Guardians Back to School Supplement, cuz
it's the most wonderful time of the year.
Put your students in the latest styles at the lowest prices, because summer break is almost over and our Back to School Supplement is filled with brand name back to school supplies at discounted prices, store locations, hours, and contact details.
It's the happiest season.
Advertisers, call the Nassau Guardian today at 302-2300 or call your account executive to get in on the two-insertion deal. If it's uniforms, shoes, books, backpacks, calculators, art supplies, laptops, tablets, or whatever is on your back-to-school supply list, your ad should be in the Nassau Guardian's back-to-school supplement.
It's the most wonderful time of the
Carrie's Fabric and Uniform Store wants to get you ready for back to school.
Don't be no fool, stay in school.
They have ready-made uniforms and uniform fabrics for almost every school in the Bahamas.
At Carrie's, find skirts, blouses, shirts, jumpers, boy shorts and long pants, neckties, socks and more.
You can even have your uniform skirts custom made.
Check out our selection of embroidered cotton shirts.
That's Carrie's Fabric and Uniform Store on Mackey Street.
Call us at 393-0758 or 817-0758.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Foundation. And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, 96.9 FM radio. Howard Grant in your company, the foundation here live and in full effect on this beautiful Friday afternoon. Just being able to talk the way that we are. The paper's kind of, you know, it's spread out far and wide with these union issues. If you look in the Nassau Guardian, all the information's in there talking about Minister Pia Glover-Varro taking on this kind of position that we are honoring the memorandum of understanding with the unions. And then if you look at the picture, let me say something. These people who pick these pictures, I want to know if that's like a separate job, right? I got to ask, right? I got to ask. Who does pick these pictures, right? Did Travis pick this picture also? This picture with Pia's, the minister's eyebrow all the way up, like, aren't we? Haven't we given you something? Didn't we do this? Okay then. Okay. This kind of a posture that she's taken just with this picture alone indicates exactly what we're saying. That's what it is. You didn't throw your hand in and your hat in with the union. You throw your hat in with the political organizations. Political organizations' objective is to retain power, to access and to retain power. What you do that for? What you do that for? And you go over here to the Tribune, you can be able to see the DUT chief. Was the memorandum of understanding worth it? Belinda Wilson blasts union leaders for signing pre-election agreement. Was it worth it? Y'all should fire them. You in here listening from the union, and you as an F&M, and they go and sign a PLP agreement, y'all should fire them. Y'all listening from the PLP, and you as a part of the PLP, and you know you wasn't going to get no contract in your organization, but you watch your union, who you pay dues to on a relentless, on a continuous basis, that thing has come right out your check. Y'all should fire them.
But you don't have this kind of conversation. You can be content. You're like a little beaten. Well, I would just say it's one or two whips. With the cat and nine tail, it ain't gonna be two. It ain't gonna kill you. I might have a couple scars, but I could live with that. That's what you want. That's what you want. That's got to be the foolish thing I ever see in my life. When it happened, I didn't understand. When it happened, we say, this was not a good move. Why would you set up a unit? First and foremost, you didn't know who was going to win. Who could know? All you know is your disdain, dislike, your hate from the former prime minister as a competent authority in that particular capacity. Your disdain for that position, his posture, his mindset that existed, him sitting in that seat, you did whatever it took to get him out that seat. So you cast lot with another devil, not in a bad way. And I don't mean that the PLP is the devil. I mean that the machinery and concept associated with politics is not to perpetuate your business. My God, you in the business for yourself. Do your own business. And then when both of us sit in our official capacity, then we could come to the table and negotiate accordingly. But no, you don't want that. You don't want that. Indecent. Telephone lines are wide open, guys. Let me take the telephone call. Call on the line. Thanks so much for holding. Go ahead.
How are you today?
I'm good, man. What's happening?
I'm fine, thanks. Listen, that gentleman from the union, from the BPL union, right? He's very disingenuous. I can tell you myself, Howard. I'm a PLP supporter. I can tell you myself on several occasions he was in the PLP headquarters speaking about BPL, okay? All right? And me knowing the prime minister personally, the prime minister doesn't tell lies. If he say he's going to do something, he will have it done, okay? Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, now this gentleman is now hanging around those other guys that he hung around before, I'm being told, allegedly seeking a nomination, okay? Don't take my word, Howard. Go investigate that for yourself, okay?
You mean on the other side?
Yes, sir. The other side that he was on before, okay? Oh, he's now hanging around there with them again, now seeking a nomination.
This ain't about no union. This is about strictly politics, Howard. That's heavy what you're saying. This allegations or you got to...
I'll leave it as allegation at the time, But you do your investigation for yourself.
You know I can make a call or call to come
I want you to make a call. Praise but God. I'm saying this to you. And if so, I can prove that he was at the PLP headquarters on several occasions. You know, what he's trying to do right now is embarrass the minister, making the minister seem like the minister's ducking. He has an open-eyed policy. He can go see the minister and have a conversation whenever he's ready. Okay? Mm. Don't mind him coming to the media speaking all this garbage, juice, foolishness.
Mm.
All right? Because if he could come to the PLP headquarters and hold a meeting, and be the special guest at the meeting, don't you think he can reach out to the minister if he really wants to?
He got access.
Okay, thank you, man.
Thank you, my brother. I do appreciate your telephone call. Guys, the lines are wide open. 323-6232-325-4316-325-4259. Anywhere from the family of islands, 242-300-5720. Hit me up, 422-4796. This is one of the issues that we have in this country. Now, for me, this ain't the first time we talk about BPL union. Isn't the first time we talk about them? Isn't the first time we talk about the gentleman Kyle in his particular capacity, Kyle Wilson? Isn't the first time we talk about him? I'm not here to besmirch his particular position, nor do I know him as an individual, but we're talking about the union's position as president. In this era and dispensation, whether it's Kyle Wilson, whether it's Obi Ferguson, whether it's Belinda Wilson, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what position you sit in at the helm of any union. You have to devise a plan and understand, how do I take my members into a new era? How? How do I prepare my members for this new Bahama land? See, the PLP only bring in a new day. After the new day, we in a new era. The transition for the new day was poor. The transition for the people time was poor. Despite that political transition, we heal. And we are in a new era. And the conversation now with the incorporation of LNG, with the incorporation and concepts and ideas of being able to bring a whiteboard into to schools to modify the approach of how we're going to be able to educate our children, the access and opportunities. We've seen this rapidly moving the country forward since 2020. And if leaders, allegedly, are sitting in the posture seeking to ensure that they could fortify their position and fortify their legacy for the future, take care of their families, it's a consideration that needs to be made, not by the executive, but by the members. Who working on your behalf is the question. Who? Who? If I looking out for me and you hoping that I look out for you, but I saying I working for you, but I ain't seeing nothing done, someone got to answer. Next telephone call. Caller, go ahead.
Good day, Howard.
Hey, what's happening?
See, they talking about these people who don't lie and who ducking in car and they promise this to the union and they promise the Bahamas with BPLA can be cut up, right? I know which prime minister he talking about. But, you know, see, someone like you, like I tell you before, man, you let them 2,400 votes get away in the by-election.
My God.
Yeah. See, with your honesty, Mama Grant, you should say, look, man, call me the papa and let him escort me in the meeting and get the nomination. But talking about this government and he trying to come down on the union president, right? If they sign memorandum of understanding, they sign something. That's in writing, right?
Yeah, they signed something.
Okay, but that
memorandum, I cut on Chivago's show yesterday, and I smiled. For 2 seconds, I was in the truck, and I had to go somewhere, but I listened to the show. And Chivago started to have this kind of a conversation about how memorandums of understanding is only between the two individuals.
I'm going to speak to that, too. What I'm saying here is, that's like signing a prenuptial agreement, and they never get a marriage license. And then a marriage took place. Because now that they in power, they ain't get married to who they signed the prenuptial agreement with, which is the BPL union, right?
Well, they have a... Listen, once they get power, they are already married to BPL. That's where their position is.
No,
I'm not talking about the
union.
BPL union. No.
Okay.
The government ain't married to unions. The government married to entities.
Hey, but Howard, another thing, right? He talked about this prime minister don't lie. Well, I don't want them to... Fortune is in Salvador from 2006 with him and his general, them talking, but they want to take up for gold. You see what I'm saying? So they all know where he is and trying to rob me and my cousin Clayton Fernandez them or our great-great-granddaddy property. He talking about which prime minister he talking about?
Well, you ain't come on the show and say that the prime minister is a liar. That ain't even socially couth. Let's just be decent. You ain't come on the show and say that the prime minister is a liar. Now, I got to answer for that. You got to answer for that, which you want to. But then I got to be decent in my space. So I got to let you go. But I understand what you're saying. I do appreciate your telephone call always. And I appreciate your contribution. Now, we recognize that there may be some half-truths. There may be some missteps. There may be some miscommunication. This is how you do it. You got to structure it accordingly as a statesman. Because they got to keep their honorability intact. So let's be decent with these kind of a conversations, right? And as we talk about these things, all we're talking about is this agreement that was signed. That should be decent. Let's talk about this now. Let's talk about this. I listened to Chivago Lang yesterday talk about the Memorandum of Understanding. Chivago Lang started to talk about how a Memorandum of Understanding, an MOU, can't even stand in court. That circumstances and situations shift. That people shift and people change. And I was listening to this, and then I said, so why the concept and idea of a memorandum of understanding in the first place, or a letter of intent? Why? Why not just wait until we get our posture and position of being able to access the actual contract that both persons are sitting in the capacity of their official capacity, and they could sign this on behalf of the people that they represent? The PLP, sitting in a governmental capacity, representing the people of the Bahamas, that could make a decision to move in a particular direction, and the union agreement, who's signing on behalf of the union to ensure that things move in the right way. Why impatience? Why the impatience? But I also remembered that Renwood Wells was fired over a letter of intent. If the letter of intent or a memorandum of understanding didn't have this sort of a power, why did we have this kind of a social shakeup during that time? This is what I ask myself. You see, because what's good for Peter ain't always good for Paul. But Grammy said to me, what's good for Peter is good for Paul. But I suppose that Paul had an allergic reaction to these things. And now there's a rejection by it. But we're seeing Peter, in a particular capacity as minister, indicate that the government has adhered to these particular things. We took care of some things. You know we took care of some things. You can't say we didn't do nothing, because we did some things. Now, there's some other things that needs to be done. But don't worry, we got time. Next time, for the poor. That's what the FNM say. So the next time, when we win in 26, that's for the unions. Is that what's happening here? Let's shoot straight. Let me take the next telephone call. Call on the line. Go ahead.
Good afternoon.
Hey, good afternoon.
I could be like some of those other callers asking for some minutes back, man.
All right. But, text City Ag and send you $5. Go ahead.
So, I think, well, a caller ago, I don't know if it was the last caller, but he was talking about Mr. Wilson as relates to being in the headquarters and all that stuff, so he can have a meeting with the minister. But I don't think Mr. Wilson ever denied that he can't have a meeting with the minister.
Okay.
But he said that he can't get answers to the deal that is going on. He never said he can't get to the minister. So having access to the minister and getting information is two different things. I don't know if we understand it'd be two different things.
Mm-hmm.
Probably the caller who called maybe not think that it's two different things. But for us, it's two different things. Because I can meet with someone, but I can ask them on what's going on, and they can say, I cannot say nothing. So that's two different things.
Yeah, I see you.
So that's what,
I get no response.
That's what the person is complaining about.
From an official standpoint, well, the minister gave you official standpoint today. She said, apart from the few items in the memorandum of understanding that may still be outstanding, I think we've done an excellent job in living up to our part, living up to our end.
No, I'm talking about the BPL situation now. The Minister of Energy and Mr. Wilson.
You mean Joe Best?
Get information from the minister and the prime minister as relates to the BPL deal.
Right.
So Wilson is never saying that he can't meet with them. He's saying he can't get no information as relates to what the deal is all about and how it will affect them.
Can I say this? Because it feels like the precedent has been set and the approach that the government has taken to deal with unions collectively. No matter if you was a part of this, or no matter whether or not you throw your hand in with Obie Ferguson and on the others who signed this before the PLP won, or if you're sitting on the outskirts looking for something for you, the government has seemingly lumped unions in a position that we will get to you when we have a chance. Talk to me.
But I agree with you, and that's what Belinda Wilson said, because everyone know that was a farce when they signed that memorandum of understanding. That was only to say, okay, we can play with y'all, we can tickle y'all and all that stuff so y'all can vote for us.
That's
now
what
I didn't get your vote, I don't need you no more.
We busy.
Until the next time around.
We busy. You have to wait.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
We busy.
And that's how government plays with people.
That, continuously, you know. This ain't just happening, you know.
No, it is under all administration.
Historically, this is what they do.
Yeah. Hey,
listen, man, you know, I got a lot of things on my... Look at all these papers on my table, man. I'm trying to deal with those things. I can get to you.
And then they can remember you the 6 months before the election.
Man, listen, I did my best. Did you get a call? That's what they can ask. did you get a call? I told my secretary to call. Man, I got a transfer.
Yeah.
Thank you, my brother. I appreciate your telephone call. Thank you so much, right? Guys, are we out here? We having a real conversation. We live in this country, you know. I don't know why these people just play like we don't live here. We live here. The precedent has already been set. Kyle Wilson in his particular capacity with a desire to be able to hear back, to get clarity on these things. We've been waiting on clarity for a long time as a people. As a people, we've been waiting on clarity for a long time. We've been waiting on clarity from the by-election, from this administration, indicating that we can do a great deal of things in West Grand Bahama, and they're looking and identifying projects that was already on the ground, but they still ain't do some other things. They made promises now. We've been waiting. We've been waiting on clarity as to how, who you even having conversations with significantly that can be able to buy the hotel in Grand Bahama. We've been waiting. We've been waiting for clarity on what y'all going to be doing with the airport in Grand Bahama. We've been waiting. We've been waiting on clarity on your sign up this agreement with the XM Bank to do all these things. You say you can push down West Sunrise Highway to access these things. Who you do that for? Because the taxi drivers ain't moving nobody from the harbor to Port Lucaya no more. So who you doing this for? You're wasting money. You take $30 million. You say you can spend only $4 million for acquisition. The others to modify it. Who you modifying it for? And the tourists coming? We've been waiting for details long time. So join the bond. Join the bond. Join the crew. Jump in with us. We've been waiting on clarity for a long time, not just from this administration, from successive administrations. The Bahamian people, we sitting in this holding pattern, I tell you, we in a limbo. Nobody could put their foot on the ground when they say, listen, when the rubber meet the rubber keep your wheels spinning in the air. The country levitated. That's why we dazed and confused in many steads and positions. We're floating. We waiting with all these weighty issues for the rubber to hit the road. But nothing. Nothing. But I guarantee you, when we get closer to elections, I tell you, this budget is to get some people straight. Not everybody can get straight. Next budget is for the low-hanging fruit within the organization to ensure that we could appease them so they could hit the road and execute these things so the PLP could find themselves in a victorious position again. Only to come to you with the exact same promises. We need to stop playing games with this thing, you know. Let me take one telephone call before I get out of here. Caller, go ahead.
Hey, what are you doing?
I good, man. What's happening?
Right here, man. I only got to say, if politics is about perception, you know, we have to be careful how we do things when you go and put yourself out there in public. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about the minister now? This is the Minister of Energy. Ducking reporters' questions, because there's so many questions to be answered, you know? The Bahamas public is waiting on answers. The union is waiting on answers.
Opinion.
Everyone is waiting on answers. We see you in the newspaper taking pictures with foreign entities. We see you with foreign vehicles that you're bringing in now, but you're not answering no questions for us. How is the Bahamian public supposed to feel? When we try to get answers from you, you're ducking and you're dodging and you run it?
I can answer this with honesty. I remember under the former administration, I appreciate you because I got to go in 2 seconds, right? I remember under the former administration when Dwayne Sands, in his particular capacity, it was Dwayne Sands, and I think, you know who used to just answer off the fly also, Denicio D'Aguila. Those two people, they used to fly off the, they just not necessarily fly off the hook, right? But they used to just answer on behalf of the collective. And then there was a modification as to who could answer when they should answer. You remember when they stopped asking people just at the step of cabinet and the reporters used to, you know, kind of gather there and ministers are just going to answer questions? What happened is that some people were speaking out of turn. Okay, so Glenys Hannon-Martin, always outspoken, always straightforward, always decisive. She has a grasp of what's happening and she can give you depth and detail. So when she answers with conviction because of her seniority, because of her understanding, because of her exposure. Understand? As a junior in this particular capacity, let's just be decent. Jobeth, she's in a different era and capacity and position. And I believe, just like the woman from on the top of the hill I tell you all about, she takes directive. Everyone around the cabinet table takes directive. Some persons are more senior than others that will take a chance and saying something from a public standpoint. I don't think that Jobeth, in her particular capacity, is willing to take that chance because directives were given, especially for business of this particular magnitude. She is the minister. We accept that. But everyone around here serves at the pleasure of the prime minister. So you didn't get too big for your britches. You understand the importance of being able to pace yourself and being released to say what you have to say, whether that's written, whether that's constructed, or whether or not you get your talking points, you know to stay on this line. If they ain't got no answers, she can't give you none. You need to ask Chester, or you need to ask Fred, or you need to ask the Prime Minister. Let me take this quick commercial break, guys, and be right back after news.
Foundation. Foundation.
Do you have uncontrollable debt? Are you ready to make that move to Fidelity for a stress-free future? These loans have a built-in savings plan that pays you unbeatable interest. Ask about our debt consolidation loans today. Call 356-7764.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Foundation. And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, 96.9 FM radio. Howard Grant and your company, The Foundation, live and in full effect on this beautiful day. 323-623-2325-4316-325-4259. Anywhere from the family of islands, 242-300-5720. Hit me up, 422-4796. Just being able to read these things and kind of chopping it down. We're having a good conversation about what's happening in the country right now as it relates to these union matters. And got some telephone calls on the break and indicated that Belinda Wilson has no space to have a conversation because she stepped out of the TCU, the TUC. She stepped out of the NCTU and she formed her own union that she brought Kingsley Ferguson into this particular space. So for her to be able to talk about these things, and you know, I just don't understand. Why we call it unions? Why wouldn't we call it organized fractions? why don't we call it our grouping, right? Instead of unions, because this unity from a national standpoint, the national unions that's fractured in this country, is an amazing thing. It's truly amazing. We got to start to have this kind of a conversation of how we get ourselves back together. That's it. And I believe that this indifference that exists in this space and we can't see eye to eye for anything would always bring us back to the same point. This is where we are. This is where we are. The government has a very strong position. They have. We've seen Pia Glover-Roe take on this position, and I cannot say that I disagree with the government's position, because as a businessman, from a business standpoint, the government has done business. This is business. We've signed a memorandum of understanding. We're executing accordingly. You never required us to be able to have things within the confinements of a timeline. We never tell you a specific timeline. We said we will execute these things. We still have time. What you want? You're agitating, indicating that we've done these things. And a lot of us have taken on this kind of a posture and position that we believe that everything is from a political standpoint. But based upon what I understand now, that this may be technical, the technocrats, the administrative execution, the responsibility for those that exist within the confines of these ministries or these departments to execute accordingly. That the agreement was made and now for it to be carried out. There's another division responsible for that. Man, we got to get something, someplace for somebody. We got to get to someplace for the Bahamian people. It's an exhausting thing, overwhelming. Your forehead wrinkled, you're trying to figure out, well, what the hell is going on? Why can't we get to an objective, an idea? Why can't we get to a solution? As opposed to this relentless back and forth, especially in the national news. Let's talk about these things, guys. The lines are wide open. Be a part of the conversation. Caller on the line with us live. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, Howard.
Good afternoon, my brother. What's happening?
I want to tell you something about the naval battery, but this is not the time. Question is this. If the union was a strike, not everybody is going to leave. Not everybody ever participates in a strike. Would this PIKE organization have the right then, because the strike is not one that's viable, and they're breaking the law because they signed an agreement that the government has them held to, would they be able to replace the union members, the workers, while these guys are on strike and continue to keep the country running? Because my concern is for the smooth running of the country. I can't get caught up in all this political.
I haven't seen the details of that contract, and that's a unique question. And the government of the Bahamas has a responsibility for ensuring that they could provide, especially, okay, so BPL has a responsibility to provide energy and accessible energy and so forth and so on, the distribution thereof. So I can't say, and I didn't see the contract, but that's a good question.
All right. Thanks, man.
I appreciate you. If everybody strike, I don't know. And I think that this is what sort of the screaming and yelling and relentless questioning of the details that exist within the within this understanding. This is what they're looking for. This is what Kyle Wilson is asking for. The details associated with how do I safeguard my people. I don't know. But I could tell you one thing. If we haven't seen Joe Beth speak to it with clarity, that means for me, that they're still scrutinizing it, that if anything was designed, that they may be at the table determining if some things are in, some things are out. I don't think that you're going to set up a business plan and execute these things without being able to have first details. This is a conglomerate, a very big company, very big company. So I believe that they're behind the scenes being able to work out the intimate details of how this thing is going to be executed. Look like they didn't put the shovels in the ground. And we still haven't been able to see some stuff. Let me take a telephone call. Caller on the line, go ahead.
Yeah, Howard, if only I, this is Alan Johnson, if only I believe it's money, you'd be a millionaire.
Yeah.
You know, you should focus on what you know. I'm simply saying that's what the people want to know. They don't want to know what other people believe. Jobert Kobe could tell us what they need to know by simply presenting the documents that's been asked for them in and outside of Parliament, by the unions, by the opposition, by myself and other right-thinking individuals. Now, let me just get a point across. I know Chicago Lang spoke about MOUs, right? Now, MOUs, generally speaking, is not considered a legally binding document, except when something of value is exchanged, it changes the MOU. When they, in exchange, give the government their support, and possibly their vote influence, they got something of value.
But even that, that's a technical argument. What value is in their support?
What value is in what? The MOU. We're talking about the MOU.
No, you said when there is something exchanged,
when something of value is exchanged, their support. This isn't where you and I have something with person to person, right? Where we agreeing that we're going to do something
but
over
here. They can't guarantee you their unionship is moving with the PLP.
No, you did. Their endorsement. The MOU is an understanding that you're going to do things and we're going to do things. Listen to this carefully. The government says, we have to understand you're going to do this and you're going to do this. And that's just a plain understanding. But when the minute the government then say, but I need you to publicly say you support me, that is something of value exchange, changing the MOU. Okay? That's something of value. So
we could argue that, whether or not that could be able to stand in court.
The question is this. Right now, without anything happening right now, a union goes to the government right now, and they have a mutual understanding. They walk away. Nothing of values exchange, just a formal agreement. Right? But when the government says to them, hold on a second, but I now need you to do this for me to keep my side of the MOU, something of value has been exchanged.
All right, okay? So let's fix this. Let's fix this, C. Allen, because I ain't going to let you hang up before we fix this.
Right.
The union crafted this agreement. They presented this agreement to the FNM, which was the government at the time. They presented it to the DNA, and they presented it to the PLP. The only people that bit on this agreement was the PLP. As a result of signing this, this was done out in the open. The unions took on this position to say that we're forging an agreement with the PLP. But the PLP didn't say, come bring all your papers and things like this.
No, Howard, I'm not going to let you stretch this. The PLP could have done exactly what the DNA and the FNM did.
But they didn't.
No, that's my point. So they entered into an agreement. They called it an MOU, but they got something of value. They wasn't just saying we agreeing, because you know what they could have done? They could have went and had nothing of value. Maybe the union is who has an expectation of value also, because they could have had all three of them sign this agreement with no need for endorsement. None. We just need the three of you to agree to this. Okay? That's what we have to look at. I don't want to debate that. But however I want to talk to you about, first let me correct the guy, Demetrius, right, who called about Kyle speaking to the PLP and everything else, right? I guess I wanted to be a member. I guess I wanted to be a deacon or a pastor of this church, because I spoke to them a couple of days ago, too. That doesn't change anything, because she didn't run away.
Jesus
she
Christ.
Didn't run away from, she did not run away from Kyle and whatever. The news reporter reported that she run, duck, and hide. Not from Kyle, from the news reporter. So it wasn't like Kyle was trying to find her and he has an open door policy. His open door policy has brought him nothing. That's why he's been in the newspaper every day since this deal came out. Keep asking for the same thing over and over and over again. Tell the people, the spin doctors, to stop it. And first of all, but you know, your mommy and daddy told you half a lie. It's a half the truth is a full lie. You ever seen a half-pregnant woman?
No.
Okay. Are you pregnant or you what? You're not. You're telling the truth or you're not. The truth don't need no explanation. And this accomplishment, this argument we make all the time, well, they're making progress. Listen to me, man. If I tell you to jump across a 10-foot ditch or you die, you don't get to argue that you jumped 9.5 feet. Okay? Because you're dead. Okay? You have an agreement to do something, you can't say...
Yeah, but they're saying that, C. Allen. They're saying, we would like to believe that this is black and white. Now, when I started off with the story from a technical standpoint, you could either stand before the courts to say that you are a thief because you didn't do what you're supposed to do, or if you provide me with some of the things, then this is a civil matter. Then we have to go and be able to deal with these particular things accordingly.
No, see, the union only need to recognize that they do what they said they would do. And if they didn't, remember.
But who says that they ain't gonna do what they said they can do within the time that they got?
No, but that's what I'm saying. If they had the time they had, if they had an agreement to do this on the last day, the unions wouldn't be making noise now. So they already had a timeline discussed, because they're saying, you haven't done it yet. And they're saying, well, you know what they said? They didn't come and say, well, we have more time to finish it. They said, we have done a little bit though, right? No, see, that's a mastery of the English language. The one thing the PLP knows is linguistic contortionism. And trust me, they would have thought this through. They hadn't did it. Because the easiest thing to say is, we still have two years and
that's
2 months
to do whatever.
She
said, living up to our end of the bargain regarding our memorandum of understanding, considering that we still have time left during our administration's term, and the fact that some items were possibly low-bearing fruit.
No, that's what I'm saying. This is one thing I've learned to do. Is listen. I love this game, you know, this game of linguistic contortionism and linguistic gymnastics and lyrical gymnastics.
But if she said that we still have some time left, that means that both the union and the government understand that there is a time frame. And if she said that we still have time left, then being able to jump the gun and say that you haven't done everything that you would do, if I still have time left, you ain't give me time.
Right. No, but see, Howard, you know, I wish I could have talked to you about the thing, right? So I would tell you what your wife would have got upset. If you said, I expect you to do this and you only did that. And you'd be like, don't worry, we still have the rest of our marriage to finish it. No. There's a timeline for you to do what you expected to do. And if it takes you 1 ounce every hour and you got 3 ounces to move and 5 hours past it, meaning that you should have been finished at hour 3, and you're saying, I still have time, I have the rest of the day, That's not the expectation. There is a public dispute because there was an expectation, and one must assume they agreed to be discussing, that they had an understanding. And so what happens now is what you have is an excuse being offered as, well, we ain't getting to it like we said we would, but we will get to it when we feel like it. Okay? Not when it's end at it, because if you have the ability, let me tell you, Howard, you know, one of the most powerful things you hear people say, a promise is a comfort to a fool. But there's a caveat to that, Howard. You know what the caveat is? At the time the person is making the promise, two questions must be asked. Does this person have the ability to keep their promise? Now, let's examine the PLP. As a government, did they have the ability to keep their promise? They do. The second part of that question is, do they have the intent to keep it? See, when a person makes a promise to you, they must have both the ability and the intent. Because if they have the ability but not the intent, they're calling you a fool. If they have the intent but lack the ability, they're calling you a fool. So the fact is that if you don't exercise both your ability and an intent, you've called that person you've made the promise to a fool.
Oh, I appreciate your telephone call, my brother. Thank you so very kindly for that. I just want to touch this one last thing before I go on to the next call. A promise is a comfort to a fool. When I dissect that, I don't think about ability and intent. The one thing that pumps out is comfort. It indicates to me that if you're looking for comfort, that means that there is discomfort. And this kind of a posture of discomfort, it says to me that your vulnerability and being open to anything. When someone say that and gives you a superficial comfort, that's why you should never go into negotiations with desperation, because you're looking to be pacified, you're looking to be comforted, and that is what we're seeing here. You didn't go in sharp, you didn't go in prepared. You know what I realized? Let me tell you something. I see some people that say something, boy Howard, you don't use some boy Jesus. Some people see some negotiations I've made and they, well, I can't believe you get that. How you get that, right? You know why? Because I didn't have it before. And if I'm existing and I'm living without it, if I get checked and my family is taken care of, I'm not going to put myself in. I've already learned. Listen to me. I didn't gone through this before. I cut myself short many times and do all kind of projects for people and get nothing out of it. Nothing. After I didn't pay everybody and buy the material and do all, I get absolutely nothing. I carry things home for my wife. I tie it, my foot hurting, my back hurting, and I still can't put nothing on the table. I refuse to do that anymore. I do not walk into negotiations desperate. If I get it, praise God. If I don't get it, praise God. But I ain't changing my price. And I ain't changing my position. Fellas could tell you that. They called me. I said, well, what you call me for? You call me about my price, that means you have a price in mind. Tell me what your price is. But I was thinking this, oh, my brother, you could find somebody else to do that. They could tell you how I'd say that. Because I good. But if you're looking to be comforted, if you're looking in this kind of a posture and position and you're desperate looking for to let people know that you could do something, you will always get the messy end of the stick. Let's be decent. Let me take a next telephone call. Caller, go ahead. I'm good, man. What's happening with you?
All right, Mr. Grant. Mr. Grant, before they had signed the agreement with Pike and then different things, before they had finalized the agreements and everyone was asking the PLP administration about what's going on. So do you believe that every time they came and said, not now or whatever, that they were still finalizing stuff behind the scenes?
Now, what I know about agreements and the government, okay, I want to be decent. I cannot tell you with any assurity. I only could tell you from historic understanding and the setup of how this is. There's a couple of things at play. There is government occupation and execution for the purposes of being able to get a job and the job for the Bahamian people. That is at play. And there's also politics at play. The PLP need to show you that our administration has done some things. As a result of this, the politics which mix in with the government, right? You have politics and productivity. This is like oil and water. It don't mix well together.
Yes,
so sometimes you would run ahead of the game and say, we got these things done when the agreement of the contract wasn't signed yet. You would run ahead of the game and say, yeah, bring your things down. Because in our country, people like to see things. They won't see it moving. They won't see it in the paper. They feel like it real when they see things.
Yeah, but
the agreement ain't done yet. I know it ain't done yet.
No, I mean, see, because the reason why I asked you that is because earlier when you were talking about the reason why the minister, Joe Colby, or I think Davis, the reason why she didn't want to say anything is because they still probably trying to figure the things out. That's
she say anything, she'll be fired before September.
Yeah, see, because
if she say anything, they will move up from her position before September.
Yeah, I agree, Howard. But see, but Howard, you and I should know that she is not going to say anything unless she is given the okay from the top.
She got to.
And that's what all of us need to understand. That none of these ministers has the authority to speak.
Now, see, watch me. Let's get back to the top of this. Right? Let's get back to the top of this.
Yes,
from a political standpoint, she can't come out here and say, well, we've did everything that we were supposed to do, but we haven't signed the agreement yet. That she cannot do that. We will tear them to shreds.
Yeah, you see, but Howard, the point I wanted to make is that whenever you see them, most of the time, or if not all the time, these agreements are already finalized. You know what I mean? The only thing is that they just don't want to tell us. You see? So when you say,
of course.
So when you say that that the minister might be trying to still do little things, they might still be trying to wiggle little things behind the scenes. I mean, the only thing that they would change right now is if the people would have made a bunch of noise and really make noise louder than they expected us to. Then they might go behind and try to squeeze a little something off us. Otherwise, there's nothing to change. But Howard, earlier you were talking and you was asking, like, who's in there for us, right? You know what I mean? Who's in there for the people? And there was a day when I was talking to you about a particular individual who used to be in the House who had said that that they are for banks and big business. You know what I mean? They used to be a cabinet minister, minister of finance, I mean, something in the finance department, et cetera. But they said on the radio, unapologetically, that they don't care what we think, that they're on the side of banks and big business. And I was trying to say to you that day, and you said you didn't want to get down in the person, but I was trying to say to you that, like, did this person have this mindset when they were holding the position representing us? You understand? Because then, I mean, that is a very serious thing to consider. You know, can you imagine someone who's supposed to be representing?
You know what I like about you? You got me smiling here. I like your repurposed indecency. I feel like you.
Man,
you
come on, Howard, man. That's what you call it, Howard.
No, I won't be decent with you.
Man,
you was my
on,
guy.
Man, Howard, man.
But you know, and I know, you call a name last time, and I say we ain't gonna talk with him. You ain't gonna get me in that.
But Howard.
Now you repurpose it. I like it.
Come on, but Howard, come on, man.
I like it. I'm not gonna fight you now. I can say this.
I
fight you. But I'm gonna say this. I said to you, governments has a responsibility. Okay, so let's structure it. Let's governments. Now, we're not talking about individuals. Governments has the responsibility of finding productivity, occupation, opportunity, so forth and so on for its people, far and wide. That's what their responsibility is.
Yes, sir.
They got to find jobs. They got to find projects. They got to develop infrastructure. They got to find money. They got to pay bills. Unions ain't gonna help them do that. Small man ain't gonna help them do that. For the most part, they don't necessarily throw their hands in with organizations, but if they could accommodate them accordingly, that's what they do. Now, we've seen over the course of time that we had ministers from finance also that forged an entire ministry, left the ministry, and went working for the people that they created the legislation for. Come on
you
now.
Understand where you're coming from.
Come on now. Now, we've seen these things before.
You understand where you're coming from.
I understand where you're coming from. I'm not going to fight you.
And where's that person now?
Anyway, see you later. I appreciate you because I know where it is. I'm not going.
All right.
I listen to you. You and I know where it is. I appreciate your telephone call, buddy. We know where they are. I am simply saying to you, if we take into consideration, if we look at it, if we look at the layout of the land and we see what government entities are, that's why there's always a relentless need for advocacy. That's all, man. That's why you need a social advocate. That's why you need whistleblowers. That's why you need people to stand up, whether that's for corruption, whether that's for realignment, whether that's for an acknowledgement to understand that, hey, Bala, we out here, you know. You got to take care of us. That is why you need unions. That's why you need social advocates. That's why you need these whistleblower groups and groupings to always keep the government's proverbial feet to the fire. That's it. Because government would run crazy trying to be able to get the best deal and the best thing and give them the best terms across the world. That's it. When we started to see PPPs, we understood we was in a crunch, in a national crunch. When we started to see significant relationships being able to be forged in the country to ensure that things could be done, we understood that we were in a particular position. When we start to see Pike come down here to be able to have conversations about LNG that we soundly rejected, a decade ago. We understand that the government acknowledges that we cannot sustain and maintain this position. That the push that the Prime Minister has had as it relates to climate change and what's going on, he needs to make modification to the fossil fuel that exists in this place. Now, if the government has taken baby steps, there's some other things at play here. Some other things, if you ask Howard, there's some other things at play. Okay? The reason why governments take baby steps is to ensure that those people that they support on the outskirts can be able to move at a measured pace to find themselves in the position that money could flow back through them. We're dealing with a lot in this country, you know. That's why we need advocates. We don't need no sellouts. We need advocates. We need people who could stand up and speak for us and know that they're not compromised. We're dealing with a lot in this country, you know. You wouldn't have nothing. Your churn wouldn't have nothing if it wasn't for some fighters. And then you throw your lot in with these people. That means you wasn't concerned about us in the first place. I just want to be decent as I say these things and have good conversation. When I get back, I want to read all these texts that I got coming through to be able to talk about these things. Let me take this quick commercial break, ladies and gentlemen, and be right back after this.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Bonneville Bones, established in 1970, is the leader in men's fashion in the Bahamas. We're conveniently located in the Mall at Marathon and the Harbor Bay Shopping Plaza, and fully stocked with everything you need for all occasions. Our Harbor Bay location is one door north of Alive, with the black and white signage of Bonneville Boutique. Both locations are open from 10 to 7 p.m., Monday through Saturday. Bonneville Bones and Bonneville Boutique, still the leader in men's fashion. Located in the Mall at Marathon and the Harbor Bay Shopping Plaza.
The Guardian Media Group has your ticket to Paris.
On your marks, get set, go!
Join the Guardian Media Group, Star 106 Hits, Guardian Radio 96.9, and Hot 91 FM. And follow Team Bahamas from Paradise to Paris. Live comprehensive updates on Team Bahamas every day during the 2024 Summer Olympics. We are your ticket to Paris. Nassau Guardian sports editor Sheldon Longley will be trackside, bringing you closest to our athletes in their quest for gold. From Paradise to Paris, the 2024 Summer Olympics, live updates, brought to you by gold sponsors, the Bahamas Ministry of Tourism, Jimmy Wines and Spirits, distributors of Refreshing Sands Beer, silver sponsor Executive Motors, and the bronze sponsors Hertz Rent-A-Car, Magico Insurance, Bay Street Garage, Nassau Motors, your Chevy and Honda dealers, and New Life Natural. Let the games begin.
That was a fantastic last leg by Ramon Miller of the Bahamas.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Foundation. 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 The foundation.
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, 96.9 FM Radio, Howard Grant and your company. I want to read this quick article, then I want to read some text. This is an article from the Tribune. It says, government not honoring industrial agreements. This is from the Tribune for June 10th, 2024. So let's see if we can be able to read this. So since a trade union leader was warning of the rise of workplace tensions as he accused various government agencies of failing to either honor or execute industrial agreement. Obie Ferguson, KC, the trade union's Congress, president told the Tribune Business that the government is not living up to its side of the bargain made in the memorandum of understanding agreed with the labor movement prior to the 2021 election, when even though the unions have lived up to our commitment to maintain industrial peace for all for at least 3 years, which I think is a very peculiar thing to say. I won't be decent with that. The unions have lived up to its agreement, to our commitment to maintain industrial peace for at least 3 years. That is absolutely bananas. I could chop this thing down all the way. Maintaining industrial peace, meaning that there's no social, there's no agitation socially from the unions, not that there's no tribulation in the workplace. Isn't that crazy? No matter what happened for 3 years, we ain't gonna say nothing about it. That's all you're saying here. So you put this, you levy it on the shoulders of the workers again. Let's be decent. And then it goes further and it says that in his address to Mark last Friday, remember this is June 10th from the Tribune. Last Friday's holiday, he called the Prime Minister, Philip Brave Davis, to intervene in at least 8 industrial relations situations involving both the private and the public sector that are becoming increasingly contentious for our government to live up to the commitments that it made in the Memorandum of Understanding while in opposition. The major problem that we have now is we made a commitment to the government and we'll try to maintain industrial peace. The evidence shows that we've done that for at least 3 years, is what Ferguson told the paper. And then he says, while what's happening now is that some of our agreements are signed but not being honored. We have signed agreements, but the relevant government departments, watch me now, the relevant government department is not honoring the terms of the agreement. We have the air traffic controllers, for example, BPL, for example. We have the agreement in Grand Bahama with Grand Bahama, with Grand Ducayan, Ducayan Renewal Holdings. We have an agreement which is completed but is not executed. We have the nurses' union, the doctors' union, and practically all the unions, the ones that they have agreed, they have not honored them, and the ones that they have completed, they are not prepared to have the agreement executed. This is bananas. Now, it sounds to me, can I say this? Based upon this, because you only let us read the thing. I won't read it. It sounds to me that your belief was that the same timeline we gave you for the 3 years of unrest, that you should execute what you're supposed to in those 3 years, was that articulated within the confines of the agreement? If that was not articulated within the confines of the agreement, then PIA and the government sector is correct. We still got time. Unless you have stipulated, specified that this is supposed to be done within this 3 year frame, then we still have time to execute these things. But you're saying that the issue is that some of these things are completed but not being executed accordingly. That's crazy. Let me see if I can be able to read a couple of these texts. I see your telephone calls, guys. You got to let me read some of these texts. Don't fight me. So it says, Howard, until we move away from the handout culture in this Bahamas, until we stop accepting the money folded in political shirts and flags, until we stand up to these no good politicians, we will never be better. Tired of the lies, man. A new day where? There's a text is coming through. He says, you get swing, you get swing. LOL, Howard, this is unbelievable. They just hate menace. LOL. Brave the wave, leave them on the wave. This is a text is coming through. So it says, why you give away the FNM slogan for the next election? Even for after 51, they ain't do nothing either. But the FNM slogan for the next election is, right? Next time for the poor, you'll need to stop. That's minute slogan. Let's go ahead. It says, I want to know who get the contract to do the work on that house by Goodman Bay Beach that allegedly owned by NIB. I don't know. Somebody called me the other day and said that they saw a fence going up in the back. They're supposed to go check it out. Howard, it's July 2024. Jo Beth told us that she'd have an answer after the FNM convention. If she can't answer a question now, what is she doing? And what is that position? I don't need a cabinet minister who's just a seat warmer, focal. already bring two big generators in, and the OM, I guess it's the OPM, said would reduce the electricity bill by July. The Pike trucks are in paper. Someone should be able to answer something. And I look at my bill for July. I said, Jesus. This is Pike has no say in the BPL. It is Island Grid, who's the contractor, who's contracted with the government. I find it extremely odd that five trucks appear on the island with a Pike logo. They couldn't go to a print shop and pay $30 for a piece of sticker and put Island Grid on the logo? And who minister inspect, quote unquote, the trucks? I didn't think that they already was odd. Island Grid don't have enough pennies to buy five trucks. What they do in operating a power facility? Y'all are wiling out. Y'all got the right questions. I don't know whether or not we can get the right answers. Says Howard, you're talking about the wrong thing. I went to pay my bill yesterday. It was $162 higher than last month. My usage is down, but my surcharge seemed to be up. She knows why she running, ducking, and dodging. She promised us the bills would be cheaper. None on the line bill was less. Big disgrace. Liars, vote them out. So did Joe Beth and the Prime Minister lie, simply didn't tell the truth. Now, that's heavy. That's heavy. The Prime Minister did actually come out. This is a text that I'm reading. The Prime Minister did actually come out and indicate that your bill in July should be lower. He says, you would also get that duck. You would also get what the duck get if you mind some of these people. Price yourself right out of business. This is a text that's coming. It says, Howard, ask the nation to pray for the young men. I'm so disturbed over the sea murders in the country. The young man was the fifth brother in the family that was killed. Mother's sick. This is just insane. We can't be silent over all these killers or these killings in such a small nation. I agree with these particular things. Let me take a telephone call. Call on the line with us live. Go ahead. Call on the line. Thanks for holding. Go ahead. Next call. Hey.
Hello, Mr. Albert Grant.
What's up, my brother?
Yeah, I like listening to you. I had fun during the first hour. You know, you always make me laugh, right? You're critically humorous.
Thank you, my brother.
But, and you study the art of euphemism, and you had a conversation with Rasta, right?
Yes.
But listen, as it relates to Goodman's Bay, right? Somebody said, I saw a text that somebody said they sold the house that's right to the east, right?
No, they say, they sold the house that used to be
on Airbnb. I'm glad to hear that, because maybe when they look through the mangrove, they'll see all the dirt and garbage are lodged in there. Just like I sent you
the pictures. Yeah, the pictures you sent me, yeah.
Yeah, but as, you know, Rasta's always hitting on some very key points, right? But I like to point out that, the question made me laugh because I'd made a previous statement she said on the radio the other day. Every day is a new day, you know. You know that, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so the executive of BlackRock World Economic Forum meeting is live on TV saying that they will force change, meaning the digital paradigm, the cashless paradigm. And you need to listen to it, because this is, I just say that to show you how the political class thinks. You see what I'm saying? You have to realize that, Howard. They have this regal way of thinking, like they think like the monarchs. They look down at us. You could, anyhow. But anyhow, Howard, I want to touch on this, right, as relates to the union, right? You know, I worked in a hotel at Radisson. You worked in the hotel industry, right?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Now, in 1990, this would have been 1997, 98, there was a strike at Radisson, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was a bit younger, so I had enough sense to know that the union, I always never really liked the union, you know. But so, while they were striking, I came to work one day, I was working maybe the 4-12 shift, whatever. So I met these bunch of people between the median, you know, the public median between eastbound and westbound lanes, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I went straight into the plant room because, you know, me and Jerome Sawyer, old man was my boss, him and Cliff Galana. So I, you know, me and the boss had a good working relationship. And everybody, they went on strike. But I rode past hundreds of people. I see them looking at me, but I dare one of them to touch me, you know. They saying I wasn't sure. But by the time the strike over, I didn't make almost $5,000 in overtime. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't realize what it's all about. I never was really, I mean, I don't hate the union, but I was on a mission. You understand me?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then as it relates to, you could help me, Howard, as it relates to a business idea, right? I'd like to, I call you on to help me, Howard, you wouldn't answer, but I'd like to put forward a proposition with you as it relates to the cannabis industry. And so maybe you'll get an idea, but I guess that was me calling you on the phone line.
When that was, you called me from a private number.
Yeah. Okay, it was not a private number. But what I wanted to say was, as it relates to the whistleblowing, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was a famous politician that said, you went to rape, when people's being raped or whatever. Who that was who said, you as a woman could use.
See you later, 52. Have a good day, okay?
You need to stop. Yeah, but when you blow the whistle, it's a problem. Give thanks.
52, my God, so indecent. You all think I don't remember these things, eh? You all think I don't know who y'all is? We talk about it. You're indecent, right? Let me take a telephone call. Call on the line, go ahead. Okay, guys, let me see if I can read a couple more of these texts. It says, good afternoon, Howard. And the Bahamas government expect for the citizens to do things on time when it comes to them. But they don't expect the citizens to expect the same of them. The government must stop being intentional in delaying on what is to be delivered to the people in general. This rusty business need to stop. I want to say something about this very quickly. The governments are not deliberately delaying. That's not the intent. The governments do not have the money. They don't. They do not have the money to execute and ensure that everything is taken care of right away. Just like you don't have the money to pay all your BPL bill that you let pile up for 3 months. You don't have the money. Unless you have the money, then we ain't having a conversation. But for those of us who, and I say us, because I have to be in this too, we got to put something on it. That's what the government does. And so this delayed posture is just the posture of a macro concept of what's happening in the country. From a micro standpoint, you just put a piece of the thing on your phone bill, a piece on your light bill, a piece on this bill, and you need some money because you don't know what's going to happen for the next 7 days, for the next 14 days, for the next 30 days that you get paid. So you need to have some money. You don't know if the chewing gets sick. You don't know if the car can break down. You need to have some floating money. You may not necessarily touch that. And this ain't me making no excuses for government, but I ain't telling you how we just live. Government don't have money. Government don't pay the overtime where these people is work every single day. They work their overtime. And the government say, we can pay you. 6 months later, you may get paid for June. We in December now. 6 months later, you may get paid for June. You hope to God you get it now. We at the end of the year. Hopefully the government is in a better position. We could get paid. This is what's happening in our country. I don't understand why y'all don't believe that. Government don't have it like that. They don't. They don't have it like that. I'm not making an excuse for the government. I'm only telling you what I know. They got to pay international bills. They got to take care of these things. People suing the government. They got to pay those things. They got to come on, man, let's be straight. Let's be decent with these things. It's a quick break, guys. I got one more break to take, and then when we get back, we can read two texts and take a telephone call. We'll be right back after this.
The foundation. The foundation.
Attention pizza lovers, Marco's Prince Charles has the deal of the summer for you. Head in and order a mouth-watering large one-topping pizza for just $10. You heard right, just $10. Call in or order online and pick up in restaurant today.
This amazing carryout offer is available for a limited time
and only at Marco's Prince Charles.
Prince Charles. This is a deal you don't want to miss because everything's better with Marcos.
The Grand Bahama News is available every Tuesday in the Nassau Guardian. You can buy your local paper at Freeport convenience stores, Western Bakery, DeGregory's Fine Foods, and Bellevue Gifts. Now is the time to reach your Grand Bahama market with affordable packages, including print and digital. Call GB News sales representative Kavandre at 822-6717 or message him on WhatsApp for ad rates. Classified ads are now available every Tuesday as well. Keep up with everything Grand Bahamian every Tuesday in the Nassau Guardian.
Now let me see now, 326 ETIC. Hello, hello, this Epic, Eckert Battery. This Miss Beulah from round the corner. I hear you're selling tires now on Wolf Road 2.
Praise the Lord, it's about time. I live Fox Hill and Fire Trail, it's too far.
That ain't all, they open Monday to Friday, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. on Sunday and holiday, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m.
My brother Sam, he's a hacker and he could go right there and get fixed up.
Call us at 326 Epic. We ship also to the Family Island.
And we're back with these couple of minutes before we get out of here. Let me see if I can take these telephone calls. Hold on, guys. It says, please, Howard, tell the people and the Prime Minister if he is unaware that LNG is a fossil fuel. You can't go around the world saying that you're switching to fossil fuels, switching from fossil fuels to LNG. The other leaders may not correct you publicly, but simply think, what is the thing that the Prime Minister is speaking on, right? So this is peculiar. I just want to be able to talk about these things. Now let's touch this very quickly. Let's very, 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 very quickly. LNG, which is liquid natural gas, and the bunker sea fuel are considered fossil fuels. However, they differ specifically in their composition and the extraction and the environmental impact. Now, we can go into this and start to find that the composition of the LNG, which is primarily composed of the methane, and then the extraction, which is natural gas, in comparison to the composition of the bunker sea fuel or the heavy fuel that we were using, which is a heavy fuel. And in those particular areas, it's really crude oil refinery, right? So you could be able to see the difference in those particular areas. I got to take this quick telephone call. Call on the line. Go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon. How you doing?
I good, Anton. What's up?
Right here, man. Just you know, listening to some of these sympathizers and persons who are licking their wounds over their loss at the polls in the last general election is really sad. Howard, you know, the fact of the matter is the Bahamian people have been suffering as a result of poor electricity, inconsistent electricity, high cost of electricity, blackout periods, lack of electricity, an inefficient operating energy company that is like an anchor on the necks of the Bahamian people. We finally have a government in place that had the know-how to go about. We finally have a minister in place and a prime minister supported by a cabinet in place that has the know-how to access, to bring in the expertise, to secure a company that has the financial pull, the reach, and the network to fund a $1 billion anchor that has been around the necks of the Bahamian people for at least 30 years, Howard. And it's very sad to see that you have these sympathizers who can't celebrate that, who don't appreciate that, who don't want to see the success of the overall people in our country by tackling the problem that is the number one problem as it relates to cost of living in our country, electricity cost, Howard. And the other frustrations that go along with all the blackouts, et cetera, et cetera. We finally are moving in the right direction, Howard. And Howard, this is what progress looks like. You have people who pull against progress, like those who pull against the National Insurance Board when it was being established. But those very same people, Howard, they used it more than any administration in the history of our country. and they did not have a plan in place to secure the expenditure that they took on in their administration. This PLP administration has to come behind and even clean up that nasty financial act from the previous administration. Howard, this government is moving in the right direction, Howard. We have some things to do, yes. We have some kinks to work out, yes. We got to do a better job in terms of taking care of our people, yes. But Howard, we are moving in the right direction. And tell me something, Howard. If a company is a subsidiary of a major conglomerate, electrical conglomerate around the planet, Howard, what difference does it make whether the company has Pike on them or whether the company has Island Grid on them? Does it make any difference, Howard?
Based upon the texter expect to be able to see the person
Howard, me and you talking now. We talking sense. We ain't talking nonsense.
Nah, I can't lie to you. I can be honest with you. If I forge a significant agreement with AT&T, let's say Amazon. Mm. I forge a significant relationship with Amazon, and Amazon say, okay, Howard, we can send you X amount of trucks and all these things like that. Listen, you're going to see Amazon trucks in Nassau. But Howard Grant get the contract. You understand what I'm saying? Howard.
Hey, Howard, hear me out. And guess what? It ain't 5 trucks, you know. It's 40, my brother. 40, not 5. You only saw 5. But there are 40 on the ground in the Bahamas to get the work done.
I ain't gonna fight him.
To prepare us for a new era of energy generation in the country. And as it relates to that last text, Howard, LNG, it emits 40% less emissions than the dirty oil and gasoline and other.
So it's a step in the right direction, but it ain't a complete turnaround. We need to be able to see
it. It is not. It is not, Howard. And which is why the government has a. Well, let me just address that point.
It's 2 o'clock, I'm done.
A 40% reduction in emissions is a major step in the right direction. You're gonna have solar. You're gonna have LNG, Howard. And you're going to be upgrading the grid. Right? We paid over $100 million for machines, Howard, and they still can't use LNG, and they still can't use the cleaner source of fuel. They are stuck using Bunker C. Why don't that individual talk about that? These people have some nasty minds in this country, but let me tell you, Howard, it's not going to stop the progress on behalf of the Bahamian people. PLP all the way.
Thank you, Fred Mitch. I mean, Anton. Today and always, it's PLP all the way. Listen, guys, I want to thank you so very kindly for being able to tune in with us today. Great conversation. I'm grateful to have this kind of a thing. I'm sure that union members and members of the government has been listening to be able to shake this up. I like your position. I like to talk about these things and understanding how we can find ourselves to productivity, growth, and development, and we could collectively, as one people, united in love and service, move forward, upward, onward together. It's the foundation. We can see you on Monday. God's Spirit Life. Have a beautiful